Okay. Thanks, Sujit. So, good morning and good evening, everyone. I'm Meghna, part of the C2000 product marketing team. And with me, I have Nima, who's part of the applications team. We also have Osama and Frank on the call from the C2000 team as well, who are going to be available to take any questions that you may have on the chat window. So today's topic is essentially going to be focusing on one of our newly launched C2000 real-time microcontroller families. It is essentially the F28003x family, and we launched in end of October. And through the session, we would like you to have a glimpse of what this device offers overall in terms of portfolio, what is your software, hardware, spec, and a lot more. So in terms of the overall agenda that we'll be covering today, we would like to start with really what is our DNA, who we are, where we are heading to from a C2000 standpoint. Jumping into the specific device family, that is the F28003x, into some deep dive on the spec, some of the migration, some of the target applications getting started, and more. Then switching gears into really C2000 plus GAN to give you a sense of how C2000 can essentially complement some of the needs of the technologies like GAN. And finally, we will be also talking about some of the key features and new IPs on this device, which is the embedded pattern generator, which is the EPG, and the configurable logic block, which is the CLB. So really, C2000 has been traditionally playing in the space of motor control, but for the past several years, we've expanded into a lot of different end equipments across automotive and industrial segments. Really all of them, if you would notice, that is tied by that common thread of being real-time controlled. So from an overview perspective, we have an experience of over 2 decades in the space of real-time control. And we're essentially working through the past several years to improve on the pillars of the real-time signal chain, be it the sensing, the processing, or the control aspects. Also, we do focus on the interface aspects because the world is now a lot more connected, and we give equal importance to that aspect as well. So it's not just on the on-chip peripherals, be it improvising on the ADC front, on the processing, let's say the C2 8X core, the co-processors, the accelerators, on the control aspects, improving the flexibility of the PWMs. So it's not just limited to the on-chip peripherals and the improvisations, but we do also offer, I would say, a lot more accessories like the software and the reference designs. Essentially to be able to help you quickly get started on the device as well as to quickly move to production for the different applications. So in terms of the overall portfolio where we are today, we have different generation of families. So what you would notice is that the generation 2 devices were essentially those that have been in production for quite a while. And the generation 3 is the current running generation of devices. We have a plethora of devices spanning right from the lower end spectra of the F28002X family, which is essentially a 100 MIPS device at 128 KB. Moving all the way up to the F28038XD device, which is essentially our flagship device, having about 925 MIPS at 1.5 MB flash. So across these devices, we're essentially looking at different performance levels at, and different price points. And into this portfolio, we're adding in our F28003X device, which is essentially a 240 MIPS device offering up to 384 KB of flash. So with this addition into our mid-performance portfolio, we are going to be enabling performance and integration at the right price point. So moving in a little bit into the spec details of what the device offers, we have the C2008x core, which is essentially our DSP core, which runs at the 120 megahertz. We also have a co-processor, which is the CLA, which is essentially running at the 120 megahertz as well. We do have a lot of accelerators on the device as well, like the TFU and the FU. In terms of the sensing piece, we have the ADCs. So we have up to three ADCs on this device running at about 4 MSPS. We have a lot of analog, starting from the comparator subsystems to the SBFM to the EQEPs. The CLB, or the configurable logic block, we will be spending more time to discuss this towards the later part of the slide, but this is essentially one of our key highlights of this device. In terms of the memory, so we offer up to three flashbang devices, up to 384 KB. We do have the lowest variant, which will be starting at the 128 KB, also having two flashbangs. On the security front, we have features like the AES and DCSM and the secure boot, which we would be adding into this particular device. And if we move slightly to the actuation aspects, so we do have the PWM, and we would continue to have the high resolution capability on a few of the PWM outputs, essentially offering about 150 picosecond of resolution. We have ample connectivity on this device, and we're also adding in CAN FP, which was something that was available on our higher end flagship devices, which we have also brought in to our mid end spectrum of devices. In terms of the overall package offering, we have four packages, essentially starting at the 48-pin QSP and moving all the way up to the 100-pin package across different automotive and industrial grades. In terms of the tooling, really what we have today is the control card. So that is available on ti.com today, so you could get your hands on the same. The launch pad will be available towards the second quarter of next year, which will be post the production timeline. From a software standpoint, we do have the C2000 way. So that's essentially our foundation software. So we will be having that on ti.com today. And the support for this particular device is also available. For the application SDKs, we essentially have two. One is the digital power SDK and the motor control SDK. So what we will have support for this device through different reference designs by the end of this month. So focusing now on some of the strengths that this device would essentially bring in, we would keep up on our DNA of really offering high quality MIPS, essentially to be able to have fast or low latency loops and running really quickly with consuming minimal MIPS as possible for the power control or for the main control loop. We would be continuing to keep up on our precise sensing with our ADCs, our comparators, and other analog. We also would continue to move on to our actuation piece with our highly flexible PWMs, which offers a lot on chip in hardware to give enough flexibility for you to offload a lot more on to the hardware rather than managing those on the software front. A tight coupling essentially between all the pillars, be it the sensing piece, the processing piece, or even the control piece, all of it together to keep up on that latency number. This would essentially be beneficial to implement a lot of the complex topologies and algorithms as well. Apart from this, on the multiple cores, so we have the C2008x core and the CLA, which would be enabling system partitioning as well as a lot of integration onto a single chip to have different tasks to be done together. On the safety and the security aspect, we do have a lot of hardware hooks now that would be available on this device, so which will essentially help to keep up on all of the trends that we are seeing with the different applications nowadays. Finally, one more that I would really pick on is the multi-bank flash. So it essentially enables certain features like live firmware update. So you're able to essentially update your firmware without stopping the control loop. And all of this without a reset. So all and more of these and a lot more features is what this device is going to essentially be able to offer. So from an application standpoint, we did take a look at what the value proposition this device offers. So we are in a good position to keep up to meet the different end equipment across industrial and automotive segments, be it if I pick the industrial drives or the server telecom power on the industrial space, or be it the automotive lighting or the traction inverter on the automotive space. So this is just a subset of the applications that we just wanted to highlight here, but we can do a lot more than what you just see on this particular slide. So overall, from our Generation 3 perspective, we have a few devices apart from the 003X, like the 002X and the 4X, which are essentially part of our mid-range portfolio. And we are able to offer a scalable platform to be able to move up and down with the different features that are available on the different devices. So essentially, the F28003X is offering a step up over the 002X device through improvements in terms of the MIPS, in terms of the flash, in terms of having a coprocessor, and a lot more analog. With comparison to the 004X device, it is essentially a next generation 4X, which offers a lot more variety of features in terms of communications, in terms of security, more MIPS, and also a lot more flash options, where it used to stop at 256 KB on the 004X devices. So this is to essentially look at the migration across these three devices families. You would notice that the migration needs to be done both at a hardware and a software front, and we offer a seamless migration across the different vectors. So we do have two guides that are available on ti.com today, which essentially details on how to move up and down across these different devices. With, in fact, the tips and tricks that we could offer to really migrate across these devices if you want to design actually a platform, a common platform that you would like to use to move across these devices as well. So in terms of the getting started, what do we have today? So the first and foremost document is really our brochure. It's a one-stop shop that gives you a glimpse of what the device has to offer, be it in terms of the configurations, in terms of the spec, in terms of migration options, and a lot more. What other collateral and content do we have on the public forum or ti.com today is essentially the samples, the EVMs, as well as the software. So we do have the superset parts available today. So the 39C is available in the 64, 80, and 100 set packages. And we have the 37C, which is available in the 48-pin packages. You would notice that we are currently in a world which has a lot of supply and demand constraints. So there is a possibility that you may find the samples which may not be available on di.com. In those cases, please do reach out to us through your field partners, and we'll definitely make sure that we can get the samples to you. So apart from really the launch and the device collaterals, we did also add in a lot more newly released content in the end of October and the November timeframe. So one is really the C2000 Academy, So this is essentially a revamped version of the C2000 training, which has essentially self-paced learning experience. We have something called as a system seek. So we have like a GUI and a tool which can essentially help a designer to not just do the pin maxing and also a lot on the code generation front, initialization, etc. And we do have a lot of guides that are available now to give you quick guidance on how to get started and go through the steps and the procedures to walk through implementing these on the devices. We do, in fact, also have guides for some of the new IPs, like the EPG, which we will be getting a peek into towards the later part of the session as well. We have a couple of technical articles really detailing how the device can be a good fit and be capable to implement a lot of the system applications, be it on the industrial side or the automotive side. So I would highly encourage you to please go and take a look at all of this new content. It would really give you a sense of what all we have to offer for this device. Switching gears really to the GAN plus the C2000. C2000 is well positioned to complement some of the needs of technologies like GAN. So be it on the switching frequency aspects, be it in terms of the reduction in the magnetics, or be it in terms of offering certain design scalability. C2000 has on-chip peripherals like the high-resolution PWMs. We have a scalable platform, and we also do have a lot of reference designs where we have partnered with GAN to showcase the capability and do quick prototyping for the same. So below is one such example of the TID-1062. It is essentially on C2000 plus GAN, and it demonstrates how we are able to get exceptionally good density numbers without compromising on the efficiency numbers. So this is currently showcased on the 4X device, and by the end of the month, we'll also be having the port available for the 3X family, which will be available in terms of the software in the Digital Power SDK. So this is one example of the design that we'll be offering. There'll be a lot more that will be coming out in the next several months as well. So please stay tuned for that. So with that, I'm going to hand it over to Nima to take you through some of the key and the new peripherals on this device, that is the EPG and the CLB.
Thank you, Meghna. Hello, everyone. This is Nima Eskandari. I'm an applications engineer in C2000, and I will be going over some of the new, very powerful, innovative modules we've developed inside our C2000 devices. With that said, let's begin with the embedded pattern generator, or EPG. The embedded pattern generator module is a customizable pattern and clock generator. This is a brand new module we're providing inside our C2000 MCUs, and it has the capability to serve many test and application scenarios. So you can use this module both for testing, internal testing of your device, and you can use it in the application if there is a need for a simple pattern generator or a periodic clock generator. So those are the main two use cases, but I will go over some other non-traditional use cases that you can use the EPG for. The EPG module can also be used to capture an incoming serial stream of data. So you can really think of this as a very customizable module that can generate or capture custom patterns using without the requirement for any external hardware. So here are some use cases of the EPG. So there are two main sections, clock generation and pattern generation. So discussing the clock generation, you are able to generate independent clocks and do clock division, so you can slow down these clocks based on the input clock to your EPG module. You can also generate synchronous clocks with programmable offsets. So if you have a requirement to generate offset clocks, you're able to do that using the EPG at different frequencies using the clock generator module. The other big part of the EPG is the pattern generation module, which allows you to generate independent custom serial data streams. You also have the ability to generate the serial data stream and an associated clock for that serial stream. So this comes in handy when you implement serial peripheral communication modules inside the EPG. So you have the capability to do that, and we'll go over some of the examples that we have available for that as well. You have the ability to skew clocks with respect to your serial data that you're generating. So this is where you can do some testing to see if your system can withstand some clock skews. Also, you have the ability to create synchronous data streams with programmable offsets with respect to one another. So multiple serial streams of data with a specific offset programmed into them, all inside this new embedded pattern generator module. Now, those are the very, you know, simple use cases that you can think of when you read about the EPG. But since this is a customizable pattern generator, you can actually do some other additional things that can help customers in different applications achieve different goals. So for example, one of the use cases is that the EPG can be used to design an additional, very simple pulse-width modulator. So this is generating a PWM waveform out of the EPG, but obviously it will not have any of the advanced features like shadowing or, you know, anything that you would, you know, require that was available to you inside the EPWM module. For example, your dead band, all of that would have to be embedded inside the custom serial stream of data that you're outputting to simulate your pulse width modulator signals. You can also generate additional clocks with specific duty and period control all inside the EPG. You're also able to add additional serial communication peripherals like we mentioned. So you can generate, you can create an SPI controller all inside the EPG to capture incoming serials of data and also generate the output data and the serial clock associated with it. Again, when we talk about creating these modules, remember that they're going to be very simple when you implement them inside the EPG, so they will not have any of the advanced features that we have inside the SPI module of the C2000. So they will not have things like FIFOs for, you know, storing the received and transmitted data. You can also generate test data patterns for internal testing of your peripherals. This is where we talked about you can generate different clocks with a skew. You can generate offset clocks. So you have the capability to do that inside the EPG so that you can do some internal testing of your device. Now, this EPG is very well connected inside your device. It has the capability to take inputs from the input X bars, which basically means that you can send in inputs to this module from your GPIOs. You also have other signals, internal signals from other peripherals available to you as an input to the embedded pattern generator. We have a table for all the available signals as inputs to the EPG inside the technical reference manual, which you can reference and see if the signals available there would match any of your needs for your application. As far as output connectivity, again, you have access to the output X bars from your EPG, so you can take signals that are generated from your embedded pattern generator out to GPIOs, and you also have ability to override existing internal signals of other peripherals inside your device. So this is where the connectivity comes in really handy when you try to do internal testing of your modules using the embedded pattern generator. For collateral and examples, obviously we have the technical reference manual of the F28003x device, which is the first device that has the EPG module. You can read about the technical documentation of how the architecture of the EPG is, the registers, and some example applications embedded right there inside your technical reference manual. We have driver lib API inside our SDK, the C2000 SDK, alongside with some examples. We have a video overview of the C2000 embedded pattern generator where we go into a little bit more details than we went over today. And you can watch that video and get an understanding of the architecture of the EPG as well. We have an application report that gives you a step-by-step guide on how to use the EPG to generate clocks and serial streams of data. This application report actually walks the user in a step-by-step manner in generating an SPI controller with the data and the clocks being generated for all different SPI modes, so all different phase and polarity modes of SPI signals. And again, hand in hand with that, we'll go the examples that we have inside C2000ware to generate both simple and a little bit more complicated custom patterns out of the EPG module. So that's the EPG module, new, very exciting, very innovative, and you know, very customizable, so you can use it in different applications. The other module that I'm going to talk about is the Configurable Logic block, or the CLB. Now, this module is extremely powerful, and you can create custom logic right there inside your MCU without the need for any external components. So you think of the CLB when your system requires adding FPGA, CPLD, or external logic. You would previously do that with your MCU plus another chip or another external logic to take care of that application. But now with the CLB, you can integrate all of those custom logic inside of your MCU. And this has a list of benefits that we will get to, but the main idea is we are absorbing a lot of the custom logic that you would do previously outside of your MCU inside your C2000 microcontroller. There's three common usages of the CLB and three main benefits of it. The first one is, like we said, replacing external hardware like CPLDs, FPGAs, and any external logic devices that you would have. The second is customizing existing peripherals inside the device. So inside the CLB, you're able to implement custom logic, and you can grab that custom logic and insert it before, after, or even inside of select peripherals in your C2000 microcontroller. And finally, you're also able to design brand new peripherals inside your device using the configurable logic block. So let's actually dive into each one of these items a little more to see some of the benefits of it. So when we talk about replacing CPLDs, FPGAs, or external logic, this will reduce the feedback latency and improve your control loop time, because everything is now being done inside an MCU without the requirement to go outside of the MCU. And obviously, when you remove these products by these external logic products by integrating your custom logic inside the C2000 microcontroller, you reduce the cost and board area by doing that. The next big item where the CLB gets used is inserting custom logic inside existing peripherals. So on the left, I have the EPWM module, which is already an extremely powerful, highly customizable highly customizable pulse width modulator. And with the CLB, you actually have the capability to insert your custom logic inside the EPWM module. So I've shown you there on the left some a diagram of the block diagram of the EPWM module, and in the red arrows that I've marked, you can actually implement custom logic and insert it inside between the dead band module and the PWM submodule inside your pulse width modulator. And the last use case of the C2000 CLB is you can create brand new peripherals inside your C2000 device. You can precondition signals, you can implement communication peripherals. So So you have the capability to do this because you have a wide range of inputs all the way from GPIOs and other peripheral signals inside the device available to you as the CLB placed inside the device with a large connectivity table available both at the input side and at the output side of it. Now, when we talk about the CLB, it gets a little confusing as to how one would go about actually implementing these custom logic, equations inside the C2000 device, and is that going to be a difficult task? To simplify the implementation of these custom logic equations, what we've actually done is we've created a CLB tool, which is integrated inside the C2000 SysConfig ecosystem. And with that, you're able to use this graphical user interface to configure this highly customizable module. You have also simulation and visualization diagrams that get generated for you to verify the logic that you just implemented. And finally, we have examples all over the C2000ware SDK that showcases how different features of the CLB can be utilized in the system. This is an image that showcases how the CLB tool, the graphical user interface tool, can actually be used inside your Co-Composer Studio environment. So again, you don't have to go outside of your main development environment to use the CLB tool. You can do it with a click of a button. You can launch this GUI, configure your modules, and go back into your C code development environment. Here are some of the resources for the CLB. So inside the C2000ware SDK, you have examples, you have links to the CLB tool user guide, which gives the user step-by-step instruction of the tools that they need to install and how they would go about getting started. We have the application note, how to design with the CLB. Now, that is a step-by-step guide of how you would go thinking about an application within the CLB and how you go implement it in a step-by-step manner inside the CLB with images and examples to walk you through everything that you need to do inside Co-Composer Studio and System Configuration Tool. Finally, we have another application report that walks users who are looking to migrate from FPGAs and CPLDs to implement their custom logic inside the CLB. And we have video training series, which range from talking about the CLB architecture to talking about the CLB tool. Also, configurable logic block introduction videos, which comes in really handy when talking to new customers about this exciting new peripheral. That is all I have. I hope this was beneficial to you and helpful for you and your customers. So you can visit www.ti.com/npu for more information on the new product updates and calendar. The recording for this video will also be available at this website.
Great, thank you so much. And if anybody has any further questions, we'll stick on the line for about a minute. If we don't see anything, we'll go ahead and end today's call. And a big thank you to our presenters. Okay, I don't see any questions. So a big thank you to all of you for attending. And we will see you next year for the 2022 NPU training series. Have a happy holiday.
Bye.